So glad you got to hear Dave and Cindy's story. Some of you know them and know them well. Their daughter, by the way, was baptized right here last night in our baptism service, and that was a lot of fun. But I just am grateful they were willing to share their journey with you. It's not an easy thing to talk about, money and giving and generosity, but it's so important. If you've been with us, you know this series on the Neighborhood Impact, anchored in the parable of the Good Samaritan, which is told to us in Luke chapter 10. And the parable itself is really about what it means to be transformed by the gospel. We know, we saw in that parable that the typical way to understand it is that, you know, that you go out and try hard to be a good Samaritan, but actually God is transforming our hearts. We're the ones dying in the road, and he comes to redeem us and bring us back to life. And then the marks of that person, of a changed heart, are gospel compassion. We talked about that last week, how we see and move toward people in need. And then another mark is gospel generosity, how we view and interact with and think about our resources. When you study the Gospel of Luke, by the way, this parable is right kind of in the center of the middle of the Gospel of Luke. And you realize that in the center of Luke's Gospel, in the beginning he's talking about the kind of proving who Jesus is. And toward the end he's talking about his death and resurrection, that significance. In the center is a collection of teachings of Jesus on what it really looks like, what it means to follow him. And when you look through the gospel, the middle part of Gospel of Luke, so think about this with me. The middle of Luke's gospel is Jesus teaching us about what it means to follow him. Do you know what the predominant issue he deals with? In Luke chapter 12, the parable of the rich fool. In Luke 14, the cost of discipleship. Luke 16, the parable of the shrewd manager and the rich man and Lazarus. In Luke 18, the rich young ruler and the Pharisee and the tax collector. Luke 19, the parable of the talents and how we invest. And Jesus drives out the money changers in the temple. Right? Overwhelmingly, the number one thing Jesus addresses when he wants to teach us about what it looks like to follow him is how we handle our money. He doesn't, the thing Jesus talks about most is not heaven, not hell, not faith. It's wealth. Why would that be? Do you know that of the 38 parables Jesus told, 16 of them deal directly with money and finances? One out of every 10 verses in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John deals with this issue. One in 10. There are 500 verses in the Gospels about faith, 500, a little less than 500 about heaven, more than 2,000 about money. But we come to church and I hope he's not talking about money. Jesus knows. I don't like talking about it. But for some reason, Jesus thought it was important enough to make it the predominant theme when he talked about what it means to follow him. I think we should pay attention to that. Why does he talk about this so much? The point is that your relationship with Jesus should change your relationship with your money. And your relationship with your money is often the thing that's in your way of your relationship with Jesus. Generosity is right here in the story of the Good Samaritan. It's all over it, really. The whole story is about the cost of rescuing this guy. Let's look again at Luke 10, verses 30 through 37. You'll remember that the religious leader comes to Jesus in this story and asks him what he has to do to inherit eternal life, and Jesus tells him this story when he asks the question, "Who is my neighbor?" So Luke 10, verses 30 through 37. Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him, bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Whatever more, take care of him, whatever more you spend, I'll repay you when I come back.' Which of these three do you think proved to be neighbor to the man who fell among robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise." Now we typically read that story and think of it in those terms, right? Go home and try hard to be a good neighbor. But most of us already know we should try hard and be better than we are. The heart of the parable is not go home and try hard. The heart of the parable is the gospel's this. You are the person dying in the road, spiritually speaking. And Jesus, who owes you nothing, comes to you to give you his very life, to pick you up, to restore you to life, to forgive your sin, to bring you into his family, and then to send you back out into the world to find others dying in the roadway. That's the heart of the parable. When that truth gets inside of you, it changes how you think about your whole life, including how you think about your money. The first thing we see here is that generosity is risky. It's risky. Think about this. This man who stopped to help a Samaritan gets off his animal. The man was jumped on the road, so he doesn't know how long ago this was. Are those highwaymen still around? They could be, those robbers. He gets off of his animal, puts the Samaritan on his animal. They're not moving very fast now on the way to the inn. He puts himself at risk to serve another person. They go to the inn, and he takes care of him. He spends money. He takes out 2 denarii and pays for that. It's 2 days' wages. And then he stays overnight with them. You don't always catch that. He stayed overnight with them. So he's already put himself at risk, his security at risk. He's given up his time. He's given up a portion of his wealth. And then he says to the innkeeper, kind of a blank check, hey, listen, whatever else he owes you, charge it to me. It's a remarkable story of generosity. But you can't love this guy without taking some risk. It's costly. The simple truth is that most of us, in large ways and in small ways, attach some measure of our security and our significance to our wealth, at least to some degree. I don't think, some people will say, well, money's an idol in our culture. I actually don't think that's true. I don't think money is an idol like a false god, but I do think money reveals your false gods. I don't think you pull out your dollar bills and spread them on your bed at night and worship them. You know, I don't think you do that. I don't think you look up your 401k and praise it, you know? Maybe you weep over it, but whatever, right? I don't think we worship our wealth, but whatever we use our wealth to acquire points in a direction where our hearts are leaning, doesn't it? Think about it this way. What's easy for you to spend on? Nope, you don't think about it. It's no issue. You don't worry about it. It's just easy to spend. That's probably where your true God is. So if you don't spend at all, maybe you're like, I don't spend much at all. Don't be so smug, right? If you're a saver, your God might be security and control. This is how I have security and control of my life, because I build accounts that I can count on. Or if you spend on fashion, which I clearly do, maybe your God then is approval, appearance, reputation, what others think of you. I heard a talk by Timothy Keller from Redeemer Presbyterian, New York City, and he said something that struck my heart. He says, I have no trouble spending money on books. And he says, the reason is, it doesn't matter what book, I want it on my shelf, I want to buy it, I don't want someone to give me their copy, I want to have my own copy. Well, the reason is, I get my significance out of how much I know. And I thought, oh, that's me. Anybody who knows me knows that. I get nervous if you borrow my book. I want to make sure I know who's got it, when's it coming back, you know? Money points us to where our gods are. And then the risk is, if my security and my significance and my happiness is bound up in this thing that I acquire with wealth, then when I give away my money, I'm giving away my security and my significance and my happiness, and that scares you. But if it's not there, if we get our security and our significance and our happiness and our joy, not in what money can buy, but in Christ and what he's done for us, you can't lose that. The more you give, the more you receive of it. Second thing we see in here is that generosity is freedom. Okay, but freedom from what? Well, freedom from the lie that your security and significance and happiness are in what you can purchase, are in what your wealth can attain. Money and wealth has a very unique kind of hold on us. It's very deceptive. You know, as a pastor, I've had people come to see me with all kinds of issues that are very sad, and we have a chance to process through and pray through, and I've had people come to me and say, my marriage is in shambles, or I have an addiction to pornography, or I have a serious problem with alcohol, or I have a rage issue, or I have pride issues, or I'm stuck in this area. You know, I have yet to have someone make an appointment to come see me and say, pray for me because I'm so greedy. Nobody says that. Now, how many of you would say that you believe there are greedy people in the world today? Show of hands. But we just don't think it's us. There are greedy people and they are the problem, but we're not the greedy ones. I think part of the issue is it's so deceptive. Those sins which are most dangerous to your heart and to my heart are the ones you don't see. You're not aware that you have. We don't think of ourselves as materialistic and greedy. Harvard economist Juliette Shore wrote a book called The Overspent American. It's a really good read. It's based on 10 years of research in America on household incomes and spending habits and how people think about their wealth. This statistic is fascinating. 76% of households in America making $100,000 a year or more disagree with this statement: I can buy everything I really need. You should be gasping, but you're not, because you're in that 76%, right? Think about it. That means 76% of people who make $100,000 or more think they don't have enough to buy what they really need. The richest people in the richest country at the richest time in the history of the world feel like there's not enough for what I really need. That's what it's saying. I'm in that category. We're all in that category, right? We live in this culture that makes us think there's not enough. Dave said it. I used to think I own it and there's not enough. Just a couple of chapters later in Luke chapter 12, Jesus tells another parable. We're going to jump to that one where he teaches on this very issue. Luke 12 verses 13 through 31. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who made me a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And he told them a parable, saying, "The land of a rich man produced plentifully. And he thought to himself, 'What shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops.' And he said, 'I'll do this. I'll tear down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and all my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'Fool, this night your soul is required of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God.'" The context for this little parable is what? Similar to the parable of the Good Samaritan, it's a man coming and asking a question, right? What's his question? "Hey, Jesus, tell my brother to stop being so selfish, to stop being so greedy." Did you catch that? This is an inheritance dispute between siblings. "Okay, Jesus, fix this for us." I have a friend who works as a financial advisor, and he tells me that he sees people at their worst when it comes to dealing with inheritance. He says he hates those cases. He says, "You think Christians will be better," but he says, "sometimes they're the worst, fighting over it," right? This is the man who comes and says, "I'm not getting mine, and my brother is being too greedy, so Jesus, you tell him how he ought to be more generous," basically. And Jesus says, "Take care, be on your guard, watch out." He's given us a pretty clear warning, isn't he? "Be on your guard against all covetousness." Some of your translations say all kinds of greed, which is easier to say than covetousness. So I'll just say that. All kinds of greed. Think about that for a minute. There's more than one kind. There's many kinds. You might not think of yourself as a greedy person, but it takes different forms. So the person who saves and saves and saves to protect their family and feel like they have some control and security in their world, they look at the person who spends and spends and spends and thinks, you're frivolous, you're irresponsible. The person who spends and spends thinks, you're a miser, you're selfish. But they both have the same root issue, Jesus is saying. It just manifests itself differently in different hearts. And I love the fact that Jesus does not give this guy legal advice. He doesn't give him financial counseling. He doesn't say, "Okay, you two, let's bring the inheritance, let's figure it out together." And what does he do? He tells him a story. I love that. The whole point of the story is to say the very fact that this is a fight between you and you're asking this question means you're thinking about your life and your wealth wrong. He's saying, "Those who follow me will not look at their wealth the way that the world looks at their wealth." Why do we refer to this guy as the rich fool? The parable in your Bible is called the rich fool. Why do we call him the rich fool? Well, because in verse 20, God says, "You fool." Maybe that's the reason. But why does God call him a fool? Look at verse 19. And it won't be on the screen, but I'll read it. Maybe it will, but I'll read it. In verse 19, he says, "And I will say to my soul," soul. Isn't that amazing the way he said that? "I'll say to my soul." It's deep in his psyche here. "Soul, you have ample goods stored up for many years. Take it easy. Relax. Enjoy life." right? Isn't that the American dream? The first century parable, isn't that the American dream? To get to the point where you don't have any more financial worries, where you can have the vacation home, you can have all your bills paid, you can have no more major debt, and you can just relax and enjoy life. Sure, you can give, but it's not going to affect your enjoyment of your life. That's the goal, right? Financial freedom, to get to that point. Take soul, we made it. We live in a culture that's telling us that. And Jesus says, fool. Fool. It's not what you think. This very life, this very night, your life is required of you. You're going to die, in other words. Walt Webster, longtime FBCG member, many of you know him, East Campus attender, sang in the choir for many years, great guy, good friend to many, passed away just this week. He fought cancer and was in remission, but it was pneumonia that took his life. Just too weak to fight it off. What price can you put on that? What would Diane, his wife, give standing at his bedside? Money can't ultimately buy you security or significance or happiness. Not ultimately speaking. Walt's with Jesus now. He knows what true riches are right now. We pray for his family. Jesus says, you fool, you don't even see. You're buying the lie. What's the lie? The lie that you can get your security. What's he saying when he says, I have ample goods stored up, I made it? He's saying, this is how I have security in an insecure world. This is how I have control in an uncontrollable world. This is how I know that I'm settled and I'm secure. No, it's not. Money does not eliminate worry from your life. Just ask the rich. Who are the rich, you ask? You. We don't think of it that way, but you know, in the world's economy, you are the richest one half of 1% in the world. We just live in a little bubble where we compare ourselves to the wrong people in the suburbs of Chicago. I was talking to a friend recently. He goes to our church. He owns his own business, and his business was growing, and as his business grew, so did his income, of course. And as his income grew, he did what people do, which is, you know, save a little more, give a little more, but also buy more stuff. So it was kind of fun. We bought a vacation home. We bought a place out in Galena. We bought some ATVs. We bought a barn to store them in. We bought all this stuff. More stuff and more stuff. And he realized the more stuff I bought, the more stuff I had to buy to put my stuff in. And then I had to insure it and worry about it and hire caretakers. And he goes, it got to the point where all I thought about was how to maintain and insure and protect all the stuff that I was acquiring. And I wasn't enjoying any of it. I was just trying to take care of it. You might think, okay, well, I'll trade my problems for that guy. Right? I'll take those worries. Thank you. The point is, though, you're just trading worries. Money doesn't eliminate them. G. Campbell Morgan, in his commentary on this parable, says, the rich fool thought he was an owner, but in the end, he found out that he was owned. I love that simple phrase. He was owned by his possessions. I have a good friend, I've shared this before with some of you, who likes to, if you compliment anything that he has, he tries to give it to you. His name is Jerry. I said, Jerry, I love that pen. He's like, you want it? I said, no, I don't want it. I just like it. No, I want you to have it. I don't want your pen. Take the pen. So I write with fountain pens today because Jerry gave me one because I complimented his pen. It's a thing. Like, you know, why do you do that? I said, Jerry, you're always giving me your stuff. So you have to be careful what you say you like of Jerry's. And he says, because if I can't give it, Jeff, then I don't own it. It owns me. I don't want to be owned by anyone but Christ. I said, okay, well, I like your car, Jerry. I didn't say that. Let's put this to the test, this whole ownership thing, right? Actually, he drives a beater. I wouldn't say that. But I love that statement. I don't want to be owned by anyone but Christ, not my stuff. This is the heart of the lie, right? The heart of the lie is that you are an owner. Dave said it. I used to think of it from a worldly perspective, that I owned it all. It was my choice. The Bible is crystal clear on this from beginning to end. You don't own anything. You don't own it. Psalm 24, verses 1 and 2. The earth is the Lord's and everything that is in it. The world and all who live in it. He founded it on the seas. He established it on the waters. Psalm 50, verses 9 through verse 12 says, I have no need of a bull from your stalls, says God, or of goats from your pens, for every animal of the field is mine, and the cattle on 1,000 hills are mine. I know every bird in the mountains and the insects in the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine and all that is in it. The Old Testament minor prophet Haggai, chapter 2, verse 8, says this, "The gold and the silver are mine, says the Lord." So you might be thinking, okay, the world's gods, he made it all, the animals, he's the creator, I get that, but I earned the wealth. The gold and the silver are mine, he says. You don't know, you're not an owner of anything. You might think, but what about my business? I built it with my own two hands. What about my career? I've made it. Who gave you that mind, those opportunities? Why were you born in this culture at this time and not in the 13th century in Tibet? Right? Who put you where you are and gave you the gifts that you have and the resources that you have, the education that you had a chance to have? You don't own that. You didn't earn that. It was given to you by his grace. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 says, "You are not your own. You were bought with a price." You don't even own yourself. God's the owner of all of it. Now, you could resist that. Judging by the silence in the room, some of you are. You can reject that. Doesn't make it less true, ultimately speaking. God owns it. He owns you. The Bible doesn't talk about us as owners. The Bible talks about us as stewards. A steward, the Greek word is oikonomos. It means manager, household manager. Not unlike a money manager today. Somebody who is responsible for somebody else's wealth. You entrust someone with some of your wealth to manage it well, to invest it well, to bring a good return on it. It's not an inaccurate thing to say, biblically speaking, if we belong to Jesus, we are God's money managers. How do you think he thinks we're doing with his wealth? I'm speaking to myself here as much as I'm speaking to you. You know, one of my temptations is this, is to think, well, most of my money comes from people in the church giving it to me. You know, they tithe to the church, they give to the church, and then the church pays me. And so why would I just give it right back? See the rationalization? I should be the most generous person. We've all got our ways of trying to wiggle out from underneath this. I don't own it. God owns it. This concept is foundational to the freedom of generosity. When you understand that your significance and your security cannot be bought with money, they're found in Christ. And when you understand that you don't own any of it, you're just God's steward of what he blesses you with, then you begin to experience the freedom of generosity. But what does this mean? Does this mean that God wants us to give everything away? Does he all want us all to be dirt poor and just give everything away? Yes. No, I'm just kidding. Actually, some people think that. I have a man say to me, well, I don't think I'm really a true believer because I would give it all away if I was. It's an interesting comment. Doesn't Jesus say this to the rich young ruler, which is also in Luke, right? Go sell your possessions, give to the poor, then come and follow me and you'll have treasure in heaven. Well, remember in those days, people didn't have cash accounts. Their wealth, they had currency to pay taxes and buy and sell goods, but their wealth was in their possessions, their land, their crops, their livestock. What Jesus is saying is you must be willing to liquidate some of your assets, right? To reduce your net worth, to be generous to my kingdom. Our giving should be costly to us, or it's not generous. Okay, but how do we know where to draw the line? Have you ever wondered this? I mean, I could always give more. How do I know where to draw the line? C.S. Lewis, not surprisingly, has something to say about this. And somebody, one of you, made a snide remark about my C.S. Lewis comments on Facebook. So just, there's going to be more of them now. But in his classic Mere Christianity on a chapter called Christian Charity, here's what he writes. I do not believe one can settle how much we ought to give. I'm afraid the only safe rule is to give more than we can spare. In other words, if our expenditure on comforts, luxuries, amusements, etc., is up to the standard common among those with the same income as our own, we are probably giving away too little. If our charity does not at all pinch or hamper us, I should say it is too small. There ought to be things which we might like to do but cannot because our love and our charity excludes them. I've been thinking about that in my life. Are there things that on a worldly level I would like to do but I don't because I'd rather do this for the kingdom? How would you answer that question? A friend of mine who's extremely generous sent this little story to me about a man named R.G. Letourneau. I didn't know who he was. I looked him up. He was a sixth grade dropout. He built a business that became, at the time of his retirement, the largest earth-moving machinery manufacturing company in the world, with multiple plants on five different continents. 300-plus patents to his name. He'd established two different foundations, each in excess of $100 million. He famously began giving away 90% of his income and living on 10%. In fact, there's a story where he said, he went to his legal advisor and says, "I want God to be the primary shareholder in our business." And they said, "What have you been smoking? You can't do. Are you okay?" He says, "I want 51% to go to God." And they wouldn't do it. So he fired his lawyers and got two new ones. and then he grew it to keep giving away more and more. And he famously said this: "The question I came to see is not how much of my money will I give to God, but how much of God's money will I keep for myself." It's a humbling and convicting thing. Finally, I want you to know that generosity is worth it. Generosity is worth it. Think back to the Prost video for a minute, talking about the great joy they had in giving. Remember when Cindy said that, when they get the bonus? And they think, how can we give? They get all excited and giddy about that. Let me read to you this last little section from Luke chapter 12, verses 32 to 34. This is Jesus, and I want you to hear these words as Jesus speaking to you, his church. "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Do you like how he says, "Fear not, little flock"? Little flock, don't be afraid. "For it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." I want to be clear about this. The gospel is not, give all your stuff away and then God will let you into his kingdom. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. That's what the table symbolizes. He invites you in. He freely gives. And then he says, "Now that I'm transforming your heart, that I've given you all this, I want you to see your stuff differently. I want you to see the opportunity you have to make an impact in my kingdom." Notice how Jesus ends. "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." We've heard him say that before throughout the Gospels. Most of us, if we think about it, we think that works the other way around. I will give my treasure to where my heart already is. Isn't that how we think about it? I care about this thing in my life, my kids' college funds, my retirement fund. I'll give to the things that I'm passionate about. I'll give my treasure to where my heart already is. Jesus says, where your treasure is, your heart follows. Not where your heart is, your treasure follows. I do think that's a principle. We tend to give where our heart is. But think about what he's saying. Your heart follows your money. So let me ask this question. I'm asking it of myself too. What do you do when your heart's not aligned perfectly with God? What do you do when your heart's not aligned with him, when you're out of alignment with what God wants? How do you get back in alignment? Pray more? Yes. Read the Bible more? Absolutely. Go to church more? Yes. But Jesus is saying one of the best things you can do to align your heart is invest there. You put your money there. You want to care about Apple or Microsoft or GM, which I don't really, but if you did, buy stock. Suddenly you care about that company the way you didn't before, right? That's the simple principle he's saying works spiritually in our hearts. You start investing in the things of God, you think about the things of God. You start putting your wealth in the things of the kingdom, you care about the things of the kingdom. Which of us doesn't need our heart to be a little more aligned? I do. This is why Jesus says, "Fear not, little flock. Don't be afraid. You already have the kingdom. I've already given you all these things. Now get your hearts aligned." I'll finish with these words of the Apostle Paul, and then we'll be done. Paul says, and famously in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who though he was rich, yet for your sakes became poor, so that in his poverty you might become rich." Hear that? This is the gospel. The God of the universe, who owns it all, gave it all up, became poor on the cross so that you, poor in spirit, might become rich in him. Let's pray. Father God, this is a tough subject for many of us because we recognize that it's deceitful and we don't see our lives accurately and it has a hold on our hearts. I pray by the strength of your grace that you'd begin to free us and disentangle our hearts, that we might first of all recognize all that we have been given in you. You'd free us from trying to find our significance or our security or our identity in anything other than what you have done and who you are. Teach us by your Spirit that we don't own anything, but we serve the King who owns it all. We thank you for being such a good Father to us. In Jesus' name, amen.